bless the Lord. Your will be done on this evening, God. Lord, have your way. And Lord, should there be anyone here that does not know you with the pardon of their sin, they would cry, I yield, and give my life to Jesus. Lord, I pray for preaching power, articulation of speech, memory retention, and the anointing that breaks the yoke. I pray, Lord, for your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding would blanket us all, God, that we would leave this place, Lord, just a little bit better and just a little bit closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so we want to use that as a subject tonight, watch over the flock for a safe landing.
All right.
We're flying all over this place as pastors. All kinds of turbulence on this journey called preaching. On this journey called pastoring.
Yes, sir.
But I stop by today to tell you that no church can function without designated leaders.
All right.
Thus Acts 14:23 indicates certain individuals were appointed to the office of elder or overseer by spirit-filled believers.
All right.
Who sought God's will through prayer and fasting.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
In accordance with the spiritual qualifications set down by the Holy Spirit in 1 Timothy 3:1 and Titus 1:5-9. Ultimately, therefore, it is the Spirit of God who makes someone an overseer of the church, such as the case is with your pastor. Paul's final address to the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, verses 18 through 35, is a classic passage giving spiritual principles on how to function as an overseer within the visible church.
All right.
Now, I get a little frustrated when somebody called me at 3:45 in the afternoon and said, Pastor, did I wake you up? I want you to understand that you really don't know, or perhaps you don't fathom, the awesome and monumental task that is laid on a pastor. Mm-hmm. Perhaps you don't understand, amen, the job that the overseer has. Mm-hmm. But believe me, amen, 3:45 in the afternoon, we're trying to hear what God is saying, amen, so that we can function properly in the position that he placed us in.
Right.
Praise the Lord, somebody.
Right.
So the task is not unlike that of the Old Testament prophets.
Mm-hmm.
The prophet was not simply another religious leader in Hebrew history, but one into whom God's spirit and word had entered and taken possession.
Yeah.
Right.
He was able to speak directly to people in the flesh, and he was able to even speak to dry bones.
All right.
Praise the Lord, somebody.
Yeah.
I think it's amazing, amen, that we can speak to folks looking at us, amen, but to have enough power in you and to have enough word in you, amen, that sin you would go back off with God Almighty, that you would be able to talk to dry bones and God Almighty, and hear that the power of God could raise dry bones in the dead valley.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's a gift from God that no other man, no other woman could have. And God used, amen, men and women.
Yeah.
In that Old Testament, amen, to show us his power. Because the Spirit of God and the Word were in him, the Old Testament prophet had the following three characteristics. Number one, divinely revealed knowledge.
Okay.
The prophet experienced God-given knowledge with respect to people, events, and redemptive truth. The primary purpose of this knowledge was to encourage God's people to remain faithful to God and his covenant.
Yeah.
Old Testament prophecies, amen, distinguishing feature was that it made clear God's will for his people by way of instruction, correction, and warning.
Yeah.
God used the prophet to pronounce his judgment before it occurred.
Right.
Right.
Out of the soil of Israel's and Judah's dark history came specific prophecies about the Messiah and about God's kingdom, as well as predictions about future world events.
Uh-huh.
Number two, divinely given powers. The prophets were drawn into the sphere of the miraculous as they were filled with God's spirit.
Yeah.
God Almighty.
Yes.
Though the prophets, amen, God's light through the prophets, God's light and power were demonstrated in supernatural ways in a world otherwise sealed against it.
Yeah.
There was no other way for God's supernatural power, amen, to be demonstrated but through the prophets, because everything else was against it.
Come on.
Good God Almighty, sounds familiar, doesn't it?
Come on.
And it seems like everything is against, amen, God's will. Oh, today we ought to be glad, amen, that God has placed, amen, overseers in front of us. We ought to be ecstatic about the fact, amen, that God has placed a spirit-filled pastor in the midst of the people so that they can get, amen, what only they can get from the man of God who has been highly anointed by the power of God. Good God Almighty. Somebody ought to say thank you, Lord.
Amen.
And then number three, a distinctive lifestyle.
Yeah.
The prophets, by and large, abandoned the ordinary pursuits of life to live exclusively for God. Doesn't that sound familiar to anybody in here?
Come on.
They protested intensely against idolatry, immorality, and all kinds of evil among God's people, as well as corruption in the lives of kings and priests. They were activists for holy and righteous changes in Israel. The prophets were always on offense, amen, for God's kingdom and his righteousness. They championed God's will, amen, without thought of personal risk.
Yeah.
Well, in our text, Paul reveals that the pastor is a promoter of faith.
All right.
Praise the Lord, somebody.
All right.
Yeah. Amen. Don King was a promoter. But he promoted, amen, to his benefit.
Right.
Praise the Lord, somebody. We find all kinds of promoters in this world today, but when you look at the ulterior motive, it's usually because they're doing something, amen, that would benefit them.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. But the pastor, being the promoter of faith, realizing that his task, amen, is to keep the people aligned with the faith of God.
Amen.
And in promoting the faith, he speaks of one of the major duties of pastors, is to feed the sheep by teaching God's word.
Yes.
That's why I realized on Thursday I try not to bother the doctor, amen, because I know that Thursday is his night to get before the people, amen, and teach the people the word of God.
Yes.
Now I know, amen, you've got to be excited about the word that comes to you on Thursday, amen, for those of you who go to get it. But if there's anybody here who has not been going, you are depriving yourself, amen, of heavenly benefits. And you really need to go to Bible.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Because that's where God is able, amen, to enlighten us.
Yes.
Give us an opportunity to speak back. Hello, somebody.
Yes.
Give us an opportunity to ask questions. Hello, somebody.
Yes.
And give us an opportunity to get answers. Praise the Lord, somebody.
Yes.
I know, amen, I don't mess with him on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Paul admonishes us as pastors that we must always keep in mind that the flock given to us is no other than the people that God has purchased for himself.
That's right.
With his son's precious blood.
Yeah.
Look at your neighbor right now and say, you're blood bought. Praise the Lord, somebody. Yeah. Not nickel and dime, but you are.
All right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello, somebody, and I came up, but you are, good God, you are blood bought.
Yeah.
And I get excited at the fact that when I look in the mirror and see a blood bought individual looking back at me, I'm praising God because I realize, amen, how much did I cost?
All right.
How much are you worth?
Right.
How much did you cost?
Right.
When I think about the payment, amen, for my soul, when I think about what Christ did, amen, when I think about the fact that I am blood bought, and that he bought me for himself.
Yeah.
He didn't buy me for nonsense. He didn't buy me to carry on a Saturday. He didn't buy me to talk smack. He didn't buy me to use expletives. He didn't buy me, amen, to be an outside show. Witnessing. is nothing to sneeze at. But what a job it is. Paul describes how he served as the shepherd of the church in Ephesus. He has declared the whole will of God by faithfully warning and teaching the Ephesian Christians. Consequently, he is able to say, I am innocent of the blood of all men. Now the word blood is used normally in the sense of bloodshed. In other words, the crime of causing someone's death. But here it means that if any should die spiritually and be lost forever, Paul would not be to blame. Praise the Lord, somebody. Well, if pastors do not want to be held responsible for the perishing of those under their ministry, they must declare to them the whole will of God, the whole counsel of God. They've got to tell the whole story. They can't hold back on any of it, but they have to stand flat-footed under the unction of the Holy Ghost, amen, and allow, amen, the telegraph, amen, the text message, amen, the email from heaven, amen, to enter into his heart so that he can deliver the message to the people of God. You get it? Praise the Lord, somebody. Because God is the one who delivers the message through the instrument. I don't care if you don't like your suit. Don't really care if you don't like some of his idiosyncrasies when he gets in the pulpit. He's a trumpet, amen. In the hands of the trumpeter. Hello, somebody. And God is the one who blows, amen. And the words come forth. And life change. And understanding comes. And wisdom is appreciated. Salvation, amen, is never forgotten. Because of God's word. Lord have mercy. Thank you, Lord. They must preach the word, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. And refuse to be preachers who seek to please people and say only what they want to hear. Paul goes on to counsel that pastors are, amen, also guardians of the faith. Praise the Lord. In guarding the faith, the true pastor must diligently protect the sheep from their enemies. Paul knows that in the church's future, Satan will raise up, amen, rise up false teachers from within the church and infiltrate God's flock from the outside with imposters who adhere to unbiblical doctrine, worldly thought, and pagan and humanistic ideas. Both will destroy the biblical faith of God's people. Paul calls them savage wolves, meaning they are strong, difficult to handle, ravenous, and dangerous. Good God Almighty. Such individuals will draw people away from Christ's teaching and toward themselves and their distorted gospel. Baby, you don't have to go to church every Sunday, baby. God understands. Now, they'll tell you anything sitting next to you in the house of the Lord. Because they have their view, their own distorted gospel. But pastor's job, amen, is, amen, to defend the flock. To correct the flock, amen. To rebuke the flock. Come on, somebody. And to love the flock. Lord have mercy. And not necessarily in that order. I kind of believe love ought to be the top of the list. Lord have mercy. Paul's urgent plea places a solemn obligation on all pastors and leaders to guard the church and oppose all who would distort the fundamental revelation of New Testament faith. And then God told me to tell you about the true church. The true church consists of only those who by Christ's grace and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit are faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ and the Word of God. Make a true church.
All right, sir.
And because they are a true church, amen, they become, hello somebody, contagious.
Yeah.
One by one, he begins to whittle the number down to 5,000. Because the true church, amen, will pray for those who despitefully use.
Woo, come on.
The true church will love their enemies. The true church, amen, will have understanding towards those, amen, who don't even care for them. The true church, amen, will love on folk that don't love them. Because the true church realizes by keeping hot coals on one's forehead, you give them enough love, amen. Hallelujah, somebody. They turn around and cry, I yield. I give my life to Jesus Christ. The true church understands, amen, that it ain't always peaches and cream in ministry. The true church understands that while salvation is free, discipleship costs. The true church understands, good God Almighty, that this ain't about me, but it's all about the Lord. The true church understands their position in the church. They stay in their lane. They do what they're supposed to do. They call on the name of the Lord early in the morning. They sit on their bed at night and meditate on God's word. The true church is like a tree planted by the river of water, whose leaves never wither. The true church does not sit, stand, lay down with the ungodly. The true church. You ought to be glad if you're part of the true church. Don't you get caught up in numbers, but get caught up in your position. The true church. Therefore, as a major aspect of guarding God's church, pastors must discipline, correct in love, and firmly refute all within the church who distort the truth by teaching things contrary to God's word and apostolic witness. The main issue here, and I'm about to take my seat, because CH is listening. The main issue here is one's attitude towards divinely inspired scripture, which Paul calls the word of grace.
That's right, that's right.
The word of God is so powerful
that
to the sold-out believer, it will change a believer's heart in a moment.
Yes,
you know that thing about yourself that may have been in left field for years?
Okay.
And even after being enlightened by others, no matter how many times you were enlightened, you just couldn't see it.
Come on.
Until one word came from God.
All right.
And when one word came from God, it changed your whole perspective on you.
Right.
Don't worry about nobody else. One word from God can make you see, amen, what other folks have been trying to tell you about you for so long. And to think that you walk like you walked, amen, all that time, and God still loved on you. Because he knew that at some point, he was going to throw his word out.
Yeah.
And that word was going to stop you in your tracks, make you take a look at yourself, tell you to straighten up and fly right. Only because of one word, because that is the power of Almighty God. All it takes is one word. All it takes is one word, and it'll change your life. It'll change your destiny. It'll change everything about you. It will change so many things until people will say, my God, is that the carpenter's son?
Go ahead.
I knew him when.
Yeah.
It's one word.
Thank you, Lord.
The power of God's love and word caused tears to form in one's eye when they realized that one word actually transformed them again.
Yes, sir.
Because transformation happens more than once.
Yes, sir.
Don't be deceived. But I'm still waiting for some more transformation.
All right.
I said, I ain't talking about you. After all these years, I'm still waiting for some more transformation.
All right.
And every time transformation comes, tears well up in my eyes.
Yeah.
To think he loved me that much,
He
keeps changing me for the better.
Hallelujah.
And I can't even take none of the glory for it. I'm better, but he gets the glory.
Right.
I'm better, but he gets the praise.
Come on.
I'm better, but he gets the worship.
Right.
I'm better, but I acknowledge him. I'm better because of what he did for me. I'm better because somebody else get better because of what he did for me. I'm better. new. I'm better than the people I took advantage of. He made me better.
That's good.
He made me better. I don't get so excited no more when I see somebody shouting.
All right.
I don't get all excited about that. I used to get real excited. Amen. But I start looking at things. I saw people shouting, amen, and get right outside and go to cussing and acting the fool. So I don't get excited when I see people shouting no more. But I get excited when I see consistency.
Yeah.
When I see people acting better than they used to act.
Yeah.
Ooh, then I get excited. Yeah. I say, then God, you just blessed me, because at one point I thought my preacher was in vain, Lord. But when I saw just that one individual getting better, Lord. They wasn't just shouting no more anymore, Father God, but they were actually living.
Yeah.
What they shouted about, God.
Amen.
I got excited. I wanted to get back in the pulpit again.
Yeah.
God will throw your bone every now and then.
Yeah.
They throw your bone every now and then to let you know that you're preaching and you're ready.
Ah.
Only do it, God.
Only do it.
Just when the devil will kneel you down and say, you know what, I'm about to give up, and God said, oh no, you're not. Look at him. Look at him over there. My
yeah.
God, yep. Can't wait for Sunday. Yeah. You keep changing me for the better. Paul had experienced this to a certain extent.
Mm.
And on several occasions, he mentions his serving the Lord with tears.
Yeah.
Yeah. In his address to the Ephesian elders, he speaks of daily warning them with tears.
Yeah.
For a period of 3 years.
Mm.
The tears were not the result of weakness.
Yeah.
Rather, Paul saw the lost condition of the human race, the evil of sin, the distortion of the gospel, and the peril of rejecting the Lord as such grave realities, that his preaching was often accompanied by tears.
Mm.
Pastor, Dr. Wright, you could have stayed at AT&T.
Mm.
You and your wife.
Mm.
You could have stayed there.
Mm.
You both could be preparing for retirement with a surety of financial security. You could have by now had mans and gardens, amen. Timeshares in different states, perhaps even in different countries. Instead, you took on the very same sentiments as Ezekiel and Paul. You see, Paul considered his life worth nothing. Paul, how did God, his main concern was not preserving his own life. What counted most was that he might finish the ministry to which God had called him. Whatever it ended, even if in the sacrifice of his life, he would finish his course with joy and prayer that Christ would be exalted in his body, whether life or death. For Paul, life in service of Christ is represented as a race that one must run with absolute faithfulness to his or her Lord. So, Pastor, continue to keep watch over the flock of God, paid for by the precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Yes.
I said, Jesus came in, good God Almighty, took the blood and paid for the people that we pastored.
Uh-huh.
Well, that same Peter's, they hung him high.
Yeah.
Oh Lord, and then they stretched him wide. Yes, he stayed right there until he bled and he died.
Yeah.
They buried him in a borrowed tomb, but good God Almighty, Sunday morning. Early Sunday morning. He got up with all power in his hand. Now as I go to my seat, let me assure you, my friend, I got this from God for you. You are governed by his providence. In other words, God's plan is in effect. You are growing by correcting storms and perfecting storms. Faith is like film. It is developed in the dark. You are graced by his prayers. My friend, you are on Jesus' prayer list. You are gladdened by his presence. When he said, be not afraid, it is I. You are guarded by his power. The will of God will never take you where the grace of God cannot reach you. In the midst of the storm, just see Jesus. Walking on the water, just see Jesus. Walking on the water. You are guided by his purpose. God has not promised you right, smooth sailing, but he first lady, watch over the flock. Watch over the flock. Watch over the flock.